So welcome, everyone, to the Birthplace of Country Music Museum's virtual speaker series. This is a monthly event. We do it every first Tuesday of the month. This is our sixth one since we started doing them earlier this year, and we are very excited about the event that we are hosting tonight. I'll tell you a little bit more about that in a second, but just a couple of quick housekeeping. Bits of information. One is please keep yourself muted and with your video off during the program. That way we get it focused in particularly on Beth and Petunia, who are going to be sharing their insights and their experiences with us. The other thing is that we welcome any and all questions for our speakers, and you can put those in the chat. So just put your questions there. Scotty, our digital media manager, is keeping an eye on the chat, and he will be facilitating that after we get through the Q&A or the interview, the sort of conversation that I'll be having with Petunia and Beth after the film. But if you have any questions, just put them there and we will get to them. And in fact, we already had someone send a question by email that I've integrated into the interview. So that's going to be great. Tonight, we are doing something very different for our virtual speaker series because we are not just speaking, we are also screening, and we are also providing music, live music. And we're very excited. We have a screening of the 22-minute short film, The Musicianer, by Beth Harrington. And then we also have some music from Petunia along with the conversation. First, I want to tell you a little bit about both of our speakers, and then Beth is going to do a short introduction to the film before we do the screening. Beth Harrington is an independent producer, director, and writer whose fervor for American history, music, and culture has led to a series of award-winning and critically acclaimed films. Whether exploring the aftermath of the eruption of Mount Pinatubo, chronicling the history of the Aleutian Islands, or drinking up the world of craft beer brewing, which sounds like a particularly good one. Beth seamlessly straddles the line between objective journalistic integrity and passion for every subject. As a result, her films are both thought-provoking and heartfelt. Her films, The Winding Stream, The Carters, The Cashes, and The Course of Country Music have been shown here in Bristol already once at the Push Film Festival a few years back. Mm-hmm. She also has a Grammy-nominated Welcome to the Club, The Women of Rockabilly, both of which reflect her long-standing love of music. And I definitely want to talk to you about the second one, Beth, because I feel like that's one we should screen at the museum down the line. She's a rock and roll singer and guitarist, and she's most noted for her years as a member of Jonathan Richman and the Modern Lovers on the Warner Brothers Sire Records label. So we'll be talking to Beth in just a second, but let me tell you about our other special guest, Petunia. Petunia grew up in rural Quebec in exactly the sort of surroundings that a country musician would find idyllic, with old dilapidated barns, secret forts, and acres of unspoiled land. As an adult, the wandering spirit took a firm hold on his life, so he set out on the road, playing every major street corner across Canada and throughout the New York City subway system, before graduating to being a full-fledged touring musician. When he's not on the road playing shows, Petunia is also involved in the theater world, building side projects, writing scores, acting, or collaborating with theater artists. His band, Petunia and the Vipers, played Bristol Rhythm and Roots Reunion back in 2017, so he is an old friend of ours. And he has also been referred to as the savior of country music, which I love, and a man who exists in a different era, bringing the past forth as something new to be celebrated and not forgotten, which feels really apt for the film we are about to see. I am now going to hand it over to Beth. She's going to give us a short introduction to the film, and then we're going to have a quick song from Petunia, and then we will start screening the film. Beth, it's over to you.
Great. Thanks, Renee. Really delighted to be here. I have spent many years in Bristol, off and on. When I worked on my film, The Winding Stream, about the Carter family, of course, I was there quite a bit for that. And it predates the museum. So when I heard that there was going to be a museum and that it came to fruition, I was so thrilled. And I think, you know, it's great that Bristol is getting what it what it is due in terms of its place in country music history. So I'm really thrilled to be here. I was delighted to have Winding Stream play there. And yeah, love to do Welcome to the Club at some point. The film I'm talking about today is a short film, and it's a narrative film. That is to say, a fiction film, which is not really my usual thing. I usually do, I've done other narratives in the past, but mostly my work is in documentary film. And I love doing music films. But the challenge of a music film, and we can talk about this later, is that music rights and clearances and performances and all of the issues around making a music documentary make it a very expensive medium. And so when I got through Winding Stream, which took me over a decade to make, I decided that I wanted to do something that was fast, that was fun, that still involved music and capitalized on the knowledge I'd gained by working on The Winding Stream, but also was something fresh for me, and that involved actors instead of people who I was interviewing. So all of that was kind of a big departure, and we had a lot of fun making The Musicianer as a result. And it did all the things I wanted to do personally, and I hope it works for you as a viewing experience. But the big thing about working on The Musicianer was being able to work with one of my favorite artists, who I met late in the game on the Winding Stream, or otherwise he'd be in it. I still regret that. I'm never going to get over that. And that is, I got to meet Petunia and see his band, Petunia and the Vipers, and was blown away and was thrilled to be able to find an opportunity to work together. So we can talk more about that in a little while, but I want to use that as an introduction to our pal Petunia, who's going to regale you with the Carter Family song, I believe.
Great. How you doing, everyone? I guess I should just get into the song, right? We'll do some talk about that. All right. I'm going to play a super old time number. Walk wine and we'll mingle my wavelength like hair. With the roses so red and the lilies so fair. And the myrtle so bright with the emerald gear. The pale amanita, eyes of so blue. To love her and She's gone and neglected, this pale wildflower.
Yay! Thank you, Petunia. That was lovely. Well, with that, we are going to jump straight into the screening. And then after the screening, we will have a conversation with Beth and Petunia to learn more about their experience and what they're going to be doing next. But we will also have a few more songs from Petunia. So that is going to be something to look forward to. And remember, if you have any questions, please throw them into the chat. Scotty will be keeping an eye on those. And we will be coming to the audience questions after we get through the interview section. So let's go ahead and screen it. Here's the musicianer.
Forgot what time then? You there now? No, it slipped my mind somehow. No. I want to play with you. I don't mean for it to keep happening.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I'll be right there. Yeah. Okay. Sure. Give me 5 minutes. I'll grab my guitar.
Job. That was really good. Where are you guys from?
That was a really great song. Is it your song?
Yeah, thanks. Yes, it is.
Yeah, I love it. It's got that old-time feel, but it's sort of, you know, got a fresh thing. You don't find that very often. You know, people just put on like a hat and suspenders and they're Americana artists all of a sudden. So, I mean, not you guys, but the yodeling. I love the yodeling. It's just beautiful. It reminds me of the Bristol State Liners or Lamar Lansing. Who is it? Oh, I can't believe it. Vern Lockhart. It sounds so much like Vern Lockhart. Am I right?
Yeah, sure. High praise. Sounds like you know your stuff.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm geeking out. That's what I do for a living. It's my job.
So you're what, like a street busker music critic?
No, I'm an ethnomusicologist, country music. Well, kind of hillbilly, old-time, like Appalachian murder ballads and stuff. But, yeah, and string band music and some blues. That's a big scope.
That covers it.
Yeah.
You get paid to do that?
Well, after a fashion. I teach. I'm a professor at Millington. So I want to ask you about your sign, The Musicianer. Is that the film?
Yeah, that's where I got it.
Have you seen the film?
Nah, I've only heard about it.
Because it's been lost for so many years, right?
Right.
It's like pretty much nobody's seen it, right?
Right.
But I have. Yeah, I've seen it.
Really?
Yeah, I have.
I'd pretty much kill to see that.
Well, luckily you do not have to murder anybody because actually there's a symposium coming up and you have to come to it. It's going to be amazing. Here's the flyer. It's all wrinkled.
Yeah.
I'm sorry. But you should come.
I don't think I can go. Thanks.
It's free.
Oh. thanks a lot.
I know musicians are broke all the time, so yeah. Free alcohol, free food, maybe. I might be able to hook you up. No pressure, but judging by your reaction to hearing about the film, you gotta see it.
Count me in.
Yeah, awesome. Okay, well, it was so nice to meet you.
Likewise.
I love the music, love it. All right, I'll let you guys talk, but nice to meet you. Hope you gotta come. Okay?
All right.
Bye.
How do you like that Simon and Patrick guitar? It's got that light finish, you know, kind of keeps the guitar punchy.
So let me see if I understand this correctly. Sonny Jefferson was responsible for way more recordings than we originally thought.
I'm not sure there's a fully satisfactory answer to your question. I'm compiling what I think will be a comprehensive list of songs that could be attributable to him, and I am hoping to be able to talk more about this when we all gather again next year. But right now, I'd like to bring up my esteemed colleague and the co-organizer of this conference. Today, she's presenting her paper on Jotlin Verne Lockhart, Reconceptualizing Roots Music, Vernon Lockhart, and Early 20th Century Cinema. So with that, I give you the hardest working academic in show business, Dr. Joe Cullen.
Thank you so much, thank you. If anybody deserves that title, it's you, Dr. Cullen. Now onto my presentation. Who was Verne Lockhart? For a musician who'd been so prominent in his day, that being the late 1920s and early 1930s, there is surprisingly little known about him. Some speculate his roots were based in the Piedmont region of Appalachia. We do know that's where he was discovered by the renowned record producer, Ernest Stanford. But when he arrives on the scene in 1928 in the seminal recording sessions that took place in Brainerd, Tennessee, we know that he has arrived at the railway hub from North Carolina, which of course is the nexus of several rail lines, which made this a perfect place to draw a variety of musicians from across the South, anxious to audition and record. I think many of you are already familiar with the story of these recordings, thanks to last year's excellent presentation by Dr. Annette Lankford. Yes, round of applause. So I won't belabor that history here. Instead, I'd like to jump ahead to the following year when Lockhart's music career intersected with the early days of sound in motion pictures. Okay, I gotta just be really honest here. I am so excited to show this to all of you. Some of you know that this movie clip surfaced recently. We can't keep a secret in this group, you know. But for those of you who don't know, the master was destroyed in a fire at the Vitatone lot in Astoria, New York, and it was presumed that the few prints that once existed were also lost. I'll be publishing more about that later on, but for now, please sit back and enjoy The Musicianer. Somebody get the lights. Thank you.
Indeed I am.
While we wait, I don't suppose you play the tune now.
You only have to ask me but once.
Reminded of the love that came from you and the mark. Quite well for a newcomer.
I can't tell you how honored I am to be featured in this talking picture with you, Miss Campbell. Big star like yourself and all.
Pleasure's all mine, Mr. Lockhart.
Please, Vern.
Okay, Vern. Thanks.
How you liking talking pictures?
I suppose I'm getting used to it. But I can't help thinking it would be of more benefit to someone like yourself.
Well, we shall see. We shall see. It's my hope that a lot more people will come to know about me this way.
Is that your expectation? More acknowledgement, fame.
My expectations seem to shift with my circumstances, Miss Campbell.
Turn in Lockhart's career and its vague and dissatisfying ending have plagued musicologists and historians for decades. With the discovery of this film and the related materials I've referenced, a small window has been opened for all of us, and I'm convinced there is much more to be uncovered up ahead. And now the good news. It's dinner time. So there's food being set up in the atrium. And don't forget, after dinner, there's a pick-in party for anyone who's inclined. And there's directions in your conference packet. I know there are some thwarted musicians among our ranks, right? Me included. So, and if that doesn't entice you, then I have two words for you. Free booze. I'll see you guys there. Okay. Thank you.
Why, just a year ago, I was happy to be playing a theater or two, and then I was happy to be going on audition with the recording company, and then I was just happy to make a record and make some money when folks liked it. And just a few days ago, I was thrilled to be making this movie with you. Well, it seems like there's always some new opportunity out there. Something new to do, and that's exciting.
But it creates expectations.
Yeah. People expect a lot.
Is the seat taken?
You came! I can't believe you came! I'm so happy! Wasn't it amazing? It was amazing, right?
You're bowled over. I can tell you just completely. It's like it'll make you just stop in your tracks.
Joe, the room is buzzing.
No. Personal expectations within yourself.
I suppose so.
Really? You just suppose? I hear you saying you want more. You want bigger rewards. You want more people to know your music. You want adulation. Immortality.
Goes.
Doug and Margaret and I are at the table at the back, and we can have you join us when we come over.
I have been at this for a very long time. And yes, that's exactly how it goes.
I would invite you to that. It's super boring and you'll want to die.
But we're having a picket party after, and I would love you to come because everybody plays and bring your instrument. I'm gonna sing. I need a yodeler. So come and we'll talk about the film. I really, really wanna hear more about what you think. Just come to the pub, okay?
Okay.
Yeah, sure.
I predict you will get all of that, my friend. It's merely a question of admitting what you want.
Please bring your instrument. I'm gonna sing. I need a yodeler.
It's just,
I don't
know,
slip
my mind somehow.
Gotta come! Okay? I'll see you later.
lovely and so mean, as darling Esmeralda, that you love Abilene. Oh, my darling Esmeralda, that you love Abilene.
All right, let's hear it again for our own Joe Cullen, Nate Bass, and Laura Leisenstein. Academics delivering Americana! Nice! Tasty little song, my friend.
Thank you.
Not sure about your choice of venue.
Well, I just can't wait to see if his research backs it up.
Well, aren't you the belle of the ball tonight?
Joe, you were great.
Thank you. It's always more fun when Nate and Laurel are in town.
So getting back to what I was saying at dinner, Reggie, I completely disagree with you. Gary's latest tome is hardly compelling. It's certainly not original. Dixon did it better, and mercifully shorter, in that tiresome but well-researched essay of hers in the most recent Americana Music Journal. As far as Gary's work is concerned, I treat it like a fender bender. Nothing to see here. Move along.
Truly, renegotiating Southern identity? My aching ass. Gary's stuck in a feedback loop. Same old, same old. Isn't he due to retire soon? He'd look so much better with an emeritus after his name.
Ouch. Harsh.
We're just having a little fun, Reggie. What are these things for if we can't trash our colleagues?
Oh, I don't know. Quaint notions like camaraderie, a healthy exchange of ideas. Pretty passe concepts, right?
You're uncharacteristically quiet this evening, Joe. Why so sphinx-like?
I'm just beat. Reggie and I have been working really late hours getting this together.
You'd think after your big coup this afternoon, you'd be absolutely ebullient. I mean, a rare music film clip no one's seen for close to 90 years. I, for one, can't wait to hear how you managed to pull that off.
Well, you'll just have to wait. I'm gonna write it up. Don't you worry.
Well, I hope you perk up soon. Wouldn't want to see you lose your mojo.
Well, you all have been very supportive. I really appreciate it. But I am gonna go get some water. I gotta hydrate, so.
Ever the charmers.
Same, straight up. Thank you. Thanks so much.
Hey, can I talk to you?
You made it. I didn't think you were going to be able to join us.
I need to talk to you about that film.
Oh, I bet you do. It's crazy. Cool, huh?
You don't think there's anything weird about that film?
Other than the fact that it surfaced on my watch 9 decades after it was lost?
Yeah, besides that.
No. Weird how?
I don't even know how to say it.
Give it a try.
I'm in it. That's me.
But who's you?
Vern. I think he's me.
Thank you so much.
You don't think there's any resemblance?
Well, I mean, you both have dark hair. You're both lanky. You're both great singers. You both yodel like a motherfucker.
Okay, I gotta go.
Wait, don't go.
Question about the shuttle bus back to the hotel.
Oh.
Hi, I'm Reggie Thurkill. I'm a colleague of Joe's.
I'm so sorry. Reggie,
hi.
This is the musician.
Like the film?
Yeah. I gotta go.
And that was
my latest discovery.
You are full of surprises. Owen, excellent job hydrating, by the way.
That's mine too. But you can have it.
Yes.
Yes, what?
Yes, that's what I want.
Good. That's all I needed to hear.
Well, I certainly enjoyed that. I hope that everyone else did. there's a lot to think about in that. And so I'm really excited that we're going to get the chance to talk to Beth and Petunia about it now. Remember, if you have questions, to put them in the chat, and we will get to them at the end after we get through the interview part. But we would love to hear from other people who in the audience who have enjoyed the film. But let's jump straight in, because you did mention earlier, Beth, when you were introducing the film, that you're primarily known as documentary films. That's what you've sort of focused on in the past. And those films, you know, tend to be sort of revolving around American history, music, and culture. And The Musician intersects with all three of those, of course, but it is a work of fiction. So what motivated you to create the fictional tale beyond what you talked about earlier, but also one that is, what did you call it, supernatural Americana? So if you're going to go fictional, you've really gone fictional.
We're very fictional, yeah. Yes. I mean, the sort of glib answer is, you know, when you're trying to construct a story with real people about real events, and you're interviewing people, you know, you as a filmmaker, you have an idea of what you think people might talk about and might say, and that you use that information to construct a story. And it's a very long process, and you don't get everything you need from one person or two people, generally speaking. You know, in the Carter film, I talked to many, many family members. I talked to many musicians, I talked to historians, in order to construct one cohesive story. And there's a little piece of me that I have to admit wants to just put words in somebody's mouth. just once in a while. Like, I want you to say this.
Yes.
and that doesn't, you know, you can't do that in nonfiction filmmaking, but you can with actors. And that seemed, after as I say, a long, long time working on The Winding Stream, and frankly, a long time working on documentaries in general, I thought, geez, it would be really fun just to make people say what I want them to say. and then I thought it would be fun to take the bones of things I knew about, but also just do something crazy with it, you know, and upend the sort of deal with the devil trope and the and just the things I know about the music business from being in it for a while and then on the periphery of it for a really long time, what people go through to, you know, what deals they make to be famous and to, you know, get over. And it reflects some of my own thinking about ambition, about filmmaking ambition. You know, I often say I left the lucrative world of being a musician to be in the lucrative world of being an independent filmmaker. And, you know, they're very similar parallel paths there that I relate to, even though I'm not fully in the music world right now. And I also just feel like there's the story of creative people. You know, there's something supernatural about creativity and being able to channel your creativity and make something great of it. And so I kind of thought it'd be fun to explore that a little bit with a nonfiction film.
Yeah. And I did like the way you did the deal with the devil part of the movie without it being explicit. It was just sort of under the surface, and I liked that. So that worked really well, I think. Yeah. And you know, you talked about the process of filmmaking and how much research went into the Carter family film, The Winding Stream. And you know, we talked about this earlier when we were first discussing actually partnering on this virtual speaker series. Right. And you said that this film that you've made here that we've just watched, The Musicianer, has ties and influences that came out of that research and the work that you did, that 10 years worth of work on The Winding Stream, The Carters, The Cashes, and The Course of Country Music. So can you tell us a little bit about like how that has intersected with this project and what you gained from both, I guess?
Sure. The most obvious things that I think people in Bristol might appreciate are the idea that in the early days of the recording industry, many labels would send out scouts, producers to go places like Bristol and do sort of audition/recording sessions with people that sometimes just showed up. Sometimes they were, there were arrangements made in advance, but you know, in the case of the Bristol sessions where the Carter family was discovered and where Jimmy Rogers was discovered, I just thought that was an incredible, you know better than I. It's the big bang of country music. It's the beginning of what we know of as country music, but it's the beginning of the early days of the recording industry. And I really love that period. And I really love the idea of playing with that. At the same time, I really like the Jimmy Rogers Singing Brake Man movie that many people have seen. And I thought, geez, it would be fun, especially once I knew Petunia. I was like, oh, I want to recreate something like that. There are my hopes for the Musicianer go bigger than the one short film. And we can talk about that in a minute. But one of the stories that I really loved about A.P. Carter was his association with the guitarist and writer Leslie Riddle, and how the two of them would go around collecting songs together for, you know, the Carter catalog. But Leslie Riddle, as many of you know, is an African-American man who helped A.P. Carter for years. And I wanted to explore that idea without using the specifics of that. So what's alluded to in that first presentation that the professor Reggie Thurkill is doing is talking about a guy like a Leslie Riddle character, Sonny Jefferson. Mm-hmm. And I just think there's so much there to know and so much more. And part of the reason, again, going to the fiction point, is we won't ever really know all the ins and outs of that. You know, the principles are gone and we won't know what was that relationship like. So fictionalizing it seemed like a certain freedom. Mm-hmm. That I could take and tell a story about, you know, with the, using the bones of what we know about the recording industry and those kinds of associations, and do something that says something big about, you know, our cultural heritage and who makes music and why, and who gets over and why.
Yeah. Well, and the copywriting sort of side of it, you know, the story in Bristol is so interesting on that front too. So mm-hmm. I'm sure that is a big part of probably what's influenced you too, I think. Because it is fascinating how that, how Ralph Peer worked the industry so well and really knew how to do it and get those artists out there.
Absolutely.
The way songs are copyrighted when they've been songs that have been around for a very long time before that.
Right.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
You know, I'm glad you mentioned Leslie Riddle, because we've actually recently here at the museum over the last year, we've come into contact with a lady who knew him when he was older and in Rochester, New York.
I know her. Yeah.
Oh, Dina Nancy. Yeah. So we're working with her to share some of that information in a display, hopefully later this year, maybe, or early.
That'd
next
be great.
Year. But yeah. It's great to hear more of his story that we just didn't know.
And he was a guest at, I mean, it's interesting. He clearly was a nice man and endeared himself to people because he used to go to the Carter's house in Hilton's and spend time there like many days at a time. And apparently in Rochester, he got to know Nancy's family really well and spent a lot of time with her family.
It's incredible. Some of the stories and the pictures and the recordings she shared with us. So So the Musicianer is played by Petunia, who we met earlier, of course. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it's so interesting. We got a question from one of our audience members before the program tonight, which actually intersects with the question that I had about your relationship with Petunia and how you came to be working with him. And she asked, how did you come to work with him, or was the film inspired by him at all? And I sort of had a similar question about had you worked before, and what made you pick him for this interesting role of this immortal yodeling hillbilly singer? So they sort of intersect as a really great question about how you and Petunia started working on this together.
Great. Well, the fortuitous thing was that the editor, one of the editors on Winding Stream is the editor of The Musicianer. But her name is Emily Von W. Gilbert. And when Emily worked on The Winding Stream, she had the film at her house. She's known Petunia for a number of years. They're friends. And Petunia was over to be in town to play. And this is in Portland, Oregon. And Petunia saw the film, was curious about it. Emily, meanwhile, had invited me to come see the show. So all of these things converged where I met Petunia, I think on the same day he saw the end of The Winding Stream. And like I said earlier, I was so blown away by him as a creator, as a presence, as a singer, that I immediately rued the fact that we were done with the film and thought, gee, it'd be great to do something with someone like that. He's so phenomenally talented. And then later we talked after the show, and Petunia said to me, you know, if you ever need anyone to play Jimmy Rogers in a film, I'm your guy. I was like, yes, you are. You're that guy. So that was the beginning. That little seed got planted. But it took us a couple of years to kind of figure it out. But I kept saying, you know, I'd go see his shows when he was in town. I'd say, you know, I'm still thinking about that. And we stayed in touch. And then finally, I realized that all of my aspirations for my next project and, you know, doing something short, doing something fun, doing something involved music, doing something that brought the history together again, but fiction, were kind of embodied in this one moment we had about this Jimmy Rogers comment that Petunia made. So that became the basis for the script that I wrote. And then, and we got it together and we did it. And I'm still delighted and still grateful. And, you know, it was really fun and I really want to do more.
Well, we hope that you do for sure. It definitely, the sort of magic of it was there on screen. And, you know, just real quick, a sort of companion question. How long did you work on The Musicianer then before you had a film ready to go?
I think it took me a really the better part of a year to make the script the way I wanted it. Mm-hmm. And then we had to raise some money to do the shoot. So I think it took a couple of years to get to that point. And then because of the nature of the film, we had to shoot it in two pieces so that we could shoot that 1929 mm-hmm. film and then put it in the conference scene later right. in the film. So we had to shoot in like an early spring shoot and then a late fall shoot. So it took a while. It took over a year to make it, even though it's a short film.
Right.
Because films just take time.
Yes. Yeah. But not 10 years at least.
No, not 10 years. No.
Well,
way under.
So Petunia, I have a question for you now. And it's something that we touched on when I did your bio at the beginning of this. And, you know, you're obviously a touring musician, someone who's been doing music for a very long time, but you are part of that theater world. And so this wasn't, I'm assuming this wasn't your first acting job. But I know that, how did you come to be in theater? What brought you there? And what kind of work have you done in the theater world?
Someone took a chance on me at something called the Caravan Farm Theater and here in BC. They hired me to compose music for a play called The Secret Sorrow of Hatchet Jack McPhee, and then I became the musical director, and it was a really fun experience, you know, camping out at this horse. They do the show on horse-drawn sleighs over 80 acres in the winter, so everyone, there's no instruments, has to be a cappella, which was really fun to do. And that led to working with Contact Dancers on another production called Bamboozled, in which I was invited to participate with the dancers, like interact on stage, and so I got a taste that way. And that didn't exactly lead to my next gig, but my next gig was kind of random. I was on stage. I got hired to be the actor and the singer in this musical production put on by Marie-Jo Thériault. She's an Acadian French singing star. If you haven't heard of her, she's awesome. She did a really audacious production in which I appear as a toy cowboy. So I'm a toy cowboy immortalized. And I appear on stage in the burning, charred, still burning, charred ruins of the Coconut Grove Fire in 1942, which you might know, Beth.
Yeah.
It was the deadliest or the second deadliest cabaret live music fire in history, where 240-something mm-hmm. people died. Mm-hmm. Anyways, that was the third production I was in. And then I found theater-based clowning, and I fell back largely on my clowning. You know, it's not like birthday clowning, it's not circus clowning. It's theater-based clowning, so it's meant for theater. So I studied under a fellow named David McMurray Smith here in Vancouver, and I carry on doing that. I feel like I fell back largely on my clowning skills when I was acting in The Musicianer.
That's so interesting. I didn't realize that there was a theater type of clown, actually. So,
well, you saw the theater clown. That was him on The Musicianer. Yeah. That was the theater clown.
Okay.
Yeah, you know, there's times when I fall back on clowning.
Well, at least I did not find that clown very scary, so that's good. That's the stereotype, isn't it? Those clowns are scary, but I can deal with that kind of clown, I think. So Petunia, you are going to do another song for us. What are you going to share?
I think it would be fun to do this song that was in The Musicianer. So I'm going to do that one. I wrote it. It's called Live Forever in Your Heart. I'm going to play this little kazoo at times. But you leave me, you leave me, as I stepped out of the boxcar that I found to go and drive away my sorrows. I had hitched that southern clown when suddenly reminded of the love that came from you. And the boxcar door stood open and the sun comes shining. Why
Awesome. Thank you. I liked the bit about living forever in your heart. That fills in with the immortality and the adulation sort of question that you get in the film from the other actress.
Yeah. Beth kind of said she needed a song exactly that pointed at that. And so that's why it's in there.
Perfect. And I have another quick question about your kazoo, because that is not the typical looking kazoo for most people. So tell us a little bit about it.
It's here it is. I'll give you
it's a phonograph. How neat.
This is a coat hanger. and this is it's a kazoo, and it's duct taped on. I mean, it's a kazoo duct taped on to a bicycle bell.
Okay.
That is a serious kazoo.
I was bequeathed this kazoo from a fellow named Washboard Hank.
Oh, wow.
Peterborough, Ontario. So he saw me using a coat hanger and he thought, I'd like this. So when I left his house, he gave me the bicycle bell. So it was kind of, we traded in a sense.
Awesome.
Very cool.
Well, we're a big fan of the kazoo because that was on one of the Bristol Sessions songs with Ernest Stoneman and the Blue Ridge Corn Shuckers. So we also have a long blog post called it with someone who is a kazoo enthusiast, who is very enthusiastic about the kazoo. So, but I have another question for you before we go back to some questions with Beth. And that is, and I think I kind of know the answer to this, but did you find it easy to connect to this old time music and history when you were making this film? I mean, it feels like this is sort of your jam already, but tell us a little bit about that, about why or how much you enjoyed it and how you connect to it.
Yeah, I'm super connected with that. I mean, I kind of lived and dressed the part for years when I started, you know, playing on the streets. And that was a natural, becoming a musician and a wandering musician at that was pretty a real natural progression from what I was doing before, which was just wandering around, you know, traveling around. And so it was nice to have a gig. And so, yeah, I thought I connected really well with the itinerant musician quality of that character, in that that's the life I lived for years while I started, you know, just sleeping wherever. You know, traveling, hitchhiking across Canada, and you can sleep out in a lot of different places, and you can sleep in a lot of the cities. You can sleep on people's couches. You can sleep in all sorts of places, you know? So, yeah, I felt I really connected with the character.
And did you have some old-time musicians that are really influential on you?
Yeah, I mean, the classics, you know, Jimmie Rodgers, yeah. The Carter Family, Hank Williams, for sure. Then there's a host of other musicians. I could go on. The list is pretty long.
Yeah. Well, we can talk. Awesome. Well, Beth, before we jump into sort of more about the what comes next question, mm-hmm. I actually had an extra question that I wanted to ask you, because one of the things I also find really interesting about the film is the fact that it is set in this world of ethnomusicology, too, which obviously is a big part of the museum's sort of academic side of things. So mm-hmm. A lot of people might not have heard of ethnomusicologists before, but that's an interesting place to have ended up in this film. So what made you pick that as your setting?
Well, so that's another outgrowth of the Carter family film in a way. When I was working on The Winding Stream, I've been, as I say, going to Bristol for a long time, out to Hilton's, going to Nashville quite a bit to interview various musicians. And I... And also because of my previous film, Welcome to the Club, I had started to interact already with a lot of musicologists of one stripe or another. And then I started getting invited to attend the International Country Music Conference in Nashville. It's held every year. In fact, I think it's going on like right now.
I think it's in the next week or
so. Maybe next week.
Yeah. Next week or something. Yeah.
Yeah. So usually right around now they have this in-person thing. This year it's virtual. But I love the people there. I met a lot of great people, and I freely admit that the idea of the presentations and then people's work dovetailing off of each other, as Joe's character and Reggie's character, you know, dovetail off of each other and the work they're doing. And also the idea that the socializing around the ethnomusicology world is very real. People have longstanding relationships. They know each other really well, and in a way that a lot of kinds of conferences bring people together. The people at the ICMC are much, much nicer than the sniping that goes on with the ones in the musicianer. But they do have a picking party, and it's really fun. And everybody, all the professors and academics and would-be musicians all get together, and lots of people are really good, and they play together in these settings after hours. And, you know, there's beer and people have fun. So I thought, you know, that nobody knows that world except the people in it. And yeah. I thought that would be a funny way to bring out the historical part of the story and lift the cover off of a world that, you know, you might not even know existed.
Yeah. So academic conferences are definitely more fun than you would expect.
This one is for sure.
We had the banjo gathering at the museum a few years back, and it was, mm-hmm. some incredible sort of just jamming between those musicians. It was pretty special actually to hear that. So I hear you. the musicianer has been an official selection at numerous film festivals, along with winning honors in several of them. So tell us about some of the other audience reactions you've had to the film and what you hope to happen next with it.
Sure. Well, it has shown in a number of festivals, and we're really excited about that. The festivals I was able to attend, some of which happened during COVID, so they went virtual. But the ones I was able to go to, the audiences seemed to really intrigued, and it was nice. A lot of people came to it without any knowledge of like country music history. Mm-hmm. So it opened a door, I think, that way. People loved Petunia. People loved Gray Delisle, who plays Joe, who is, by the way, a singer in her own right. She's also a voiceover artist. Lots of people know her as an animated voiceover artist. She has like a huge following in that world. But you know, the genuine connection of the leads with real music, and they're, you know, nobody was lip syncing. Nobody had any, you know, that was a song that Gray wrote. That was a song that Petunia wrote. You know, there's a direct connection. I think that really, people who watched the film really liked that authenticity about it.
Right.
I've had some great conversations about the film. Originally, we were trying to push it as a beat the beat pilot for a web series that still could happen. But we're also right now hoping to see if we can construct the shape of it into a feature film and tell the story as a feature film, and maybe that use that as a jumping off point for something web-based. It's a brave new world in terms of distribution, and it just got weirder because of COVID. So places that you used to be able to do things, I mean, The Winding Stream was in theaters all over the country. Many of those theaters went under last year.
Yeah.
So as a filmmaker, I want to stay busy and working and pushing my projects. I also need to keep an eye out for what's possible. And it seems like right now, the world of the series or a certain kind of feature could definitely get out there. So we're talking, you know, working on a feature length script with another screenwriter and just trying to keep lines of communications open with all the people I worked with, because they're all great, most notably our star here, and see if we can keep going. So that's my hope. We're looking for you know, the sugar daddy to come down from the heavens. And
aren't we all?
Me too.
Or sugar mama, it doesn't matter.
Or sugar mama. I don't, yes, it's not gender specific. It could be any kind of sugar. Yeah.
Well, keep us posted, and we'll have our fingers crossed, because we would love to see it as a feature film or a web series. That sounds like fun.
Thank you.
Just your filmography in general. I mean, it's pretty wide ranging. And I also, when I was doing some research for talking to you, I found the podcast that you had done with the Passionistas, which sort of embraced a lot of passions that you have for different subjects. And like we talked about earlier in your bio, I mean, from music to miracles to beer, your sort of filmography has sort of run a wide range of things. Mm-hmm. And I wondered, I mean, how much of that, and I know also you've worked for a PBS station, is that correct?
Yeah, so I've worked for both WGBH in Boston and Oregon Public Broadcasting here in Portland.
So I was wondering, like, how much with the filmography that I was looking at and that wide range is about your own range of interests, and how much of that is something where you're following a story or an assignment from your work, or is it a combination of the two?
It's definitely a combination, but I will say that except for like a couple of very early films that I enjoyed immensely, but weren't me pushing the project, most of the films that I get to work on reflect really deep interests of my own. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm kidding around about academia, but I have operated in the world of academia because I went and got my master's degree in American studies years ago. And I went to do that because American studies is such a big, broad umbrella to look at all the things I'm interested in, things like immigration, things like music, things like popular culture, movies, you know. So I found a home for all my interests under the umbrella of American studies. And then once I kind of started staking out that territory, lucky for me, the public television entities that I worked with recognized that that was my happy place and that was where I did good work. So I've been able to do films about York of the Lewis and Clark expedition, the man who was enslaved to William Clark, or I've been able to do films about craft brewing because beer, and I've been able to do, you know, a whole range of films that speak to my interest in this country, mm-hmm. and my passion for the ideals of what makes this place great. While also saying, we get some work to do. Yeah. So I love doing those kinds of projects. Winding Stream and Welcome to the Club were definitely me all in with my music background. Right. And that was crazy good both times.
Yeah. Well, and that leads me to sort of follow up. Is there a dream musical artist or a dream sort of music focused project that you'd like to do in the future? Just if all the sugar daddies were out.
All the sugar daddies are out. Well, I mean, honestly, the dream project right now is this. I mean, I would love to be able to make this work, because I think we're just scratching the surface in the short, and there's a lot of depth there. There's a lot to explore. I mean, I feel like the academics give us a way to move about in ways around American music that I think is really fascinating and exposes the audience to different ways of thinking about this kind of music too. Not just a story like a Leslie Riddle story, but also, you know, the story of Hawaiian music, steel guitar emerging from Hawaii and coming to the South and influencing all these other kinds of acts. I mean, there are ways to tell these stories that would be really entertaining. Just a little glimmer of some of the stuff. Mm-hmm. So, I'd really like to delve more into that. And I also, because I have such great musicians like Petunia, I want to capitalize on that. You don't really hear him sing in the film as much as I would like him to sing ultimately. And also we've made contact with, I'm friendly with Dom Flemons, and he's a great performer in his own right. And I've been talking to him about maybe, the Sonny Jefferson character and how, we can bring these people to life with real musicians. Yeah. So I think there's some place between my documentary love of showing the performances mixed with this new passion for nonfiction. Fiction rather, that's really fun.
Yeah. So. Awesome. Well, and all of those things intersect really well with our museum. So I hope to see them in the future, because they'd be great to have here as a program. So, and finally, final question is for both of you. And it's just, what other projects are you both working on? What's up next? What are you doing in the future, especially now that things are starting to open up a little bit? Mm-hmm. We are moving further away from the last year and into new possibilities, hopefully. So go ahead. You go first, Beth, and then we'll go to Petunia, since he's going to do another song for us.
Fair enough. I just got some funding from the National Endowment for the Humanities to do development work on a project about a Japanese photographer who came to Washington State in 1901 and endeared himself to a community, documented, made fabulous photos of people who never get documented, both Native folks, immigrants, the white settlers of the area, and also some really interesting photos that are clownish, performative clowning, and some gender bending stuff that's kind of interesting. And this is all happening in the early 1900s in Washington State. So
I'm interesting.
Yeah, his name is Frank Matsura. He's a really interesting, fantastic photographer. He died very young. And when he died, the community came out to mourn him in numbers that no one had ever seen before in that part of the world. So he's like my it's somebody I've been interested in for about 20 years. And I finally was able to interest the sugar people to get us underway. So
I can see NEH being interested in something like that. Yeah.
Yeah. It was really exciting.
I'm glad you got that funding. That's exciting.
Yeah. So that'll be something I'll be doing while I work on the script for The Musicianer.
Awesome. How about you, Petunia? What projects are you working on? What happens with you next?
I guess I've been, I've been throughout all this, I've been writing a lot of songs. So I'm ready to record another like 2 or 3 albums. and then I have an album that was almost going to come out just before the whole thing happened. And so I'm working towards putting that album out. And then starting touring again, maybe in the fall, we'll see. We're a little bit behind you up here in Canada. Mm. So yeah. And then The Musicianer, whenever that happens, that's front and center for me. Yeah. I can't wait. I love it. It was a lot of fun. Beth is a lot of fun to work with. You don't know.
Well, I would certainly encourage everyone in our audience today to check out both of your websites. And I don't know, Scotty, do you think you would be able to put those up in the chat for people?
I put them up once already, and I'm going to put them up at the end again.
Okay. Yeah, so definitely check out their websites and follow them on social media to find out more about what's happening with Beth Harrington's filmmaking and Petunia's music making and filmmaking and theater. But before we move on to the audience Q&A, Petunia was going to give us another song. So what are you going to play for us?
I thought I'd play one of my own songs.
Awesome.
I'm going to play a song that's kind of popular. It's got yodeling in it. It's called The Creepy Song.
That was awesome. Thank you so much. Wow. I have a quick question for you, Petunia. Have you ever heard of a man called W.E. Myers?
W.E. Myers?
Yes.
No.
He was from Richlands, Virginia, so just up the road from us. And back in the 1930s, he had a label called the Flying Ace Record Label. It's really hard to find because he only released a few songs, but he did not like Jimmy Rogers because of the yodeling. And so on his record label, all his record label said without a yodel, because he refused to record any songs that had yodeling in them. So
yodel free zone.
Yes. Which we actually just met with his grandson the other day, and it just reminded me when you were yodeling. So kind of interesting. But we're going to turn now. We have some comments, lots of great positive comments from people in the audience, but also a few questions. So I'm going to turn it over to Scotty to share some of those with Beth and Petunia to answer for us.
muted. Yeah, like Renee said, there's a lot of great compliments and comments in the chat, but I'll stick with the questions for now. Oh, and also want to say thank you both for being here and helping with this great presentation.
Pleasure.
So the first one is a quick one from, let's see, where did it go here? From Andrew Hunt. He arrived late and he asked where else the film can be viewed. I told him that this presentation would be up on our site and I thought that we would include the film, but Beth, yes. Do you want to confirm that and
yes,
anywhere else?
I think that would be the best way for now to see it. I am going to try to figure out a way to push it out more aggressively in the world. We've been kind of holding off because it had a festival run and they like it if you don't show films
yeah.
before a festival.
Yeah.
But I think we've hit the last one, which was the one in Franklin. So yes, but definitely here.
Yeah, it'll be up within about probably next Monday. It'll be up. And if you just keep an eye on our social media, Andrew and everyone else, we'll definitely promote it on there. And this is a question for you, Beth, from James Atkinson. How do presentations such as this play a role in formation of future projects, if at all?
Oh, doing a presentation with the museum? You know, I just feel like the world of independent filmmaking is so Byzantine, you know. It's not, we don't have the big bucks of the to do major movie rollouts, and even those are questionable these days. But I think being able to be validated by an institution like the Birthplace of Country Music and to be able to show it in this context creates buzz among exactly the people that would most be the first tier of people we would want to reach, people who know Americana music or like Americana music or know country music or know this history. So in this particular instance, it's very targeted. You know, this is a great audience for a film like this. But in general, we just try to do stuff to let people know that's out there and, you know, get us to the next steps. It's a slow... it's a slow process to get to the next place you want to get with filmmaking. And so being able to have an audience is great. And also being able to have an audience that will spread the word is also great. So,
well, and to add to that, Beth, that validation and partnership goes both ways, just because it's great to, work with people such as you all, to get our story out there, and to audiences that may not know about us. So.
Definitely. And I think also, I would imagine that as you're going through the film circuit, the film festival circuit, the audience reactions tell you a lot about, or it might influence the way you move with a future project around the shorter film.
Yes. Yes. I mean, that's always the best thing is to see a film with an audience. And preferably, I mean, I do this with every film I make. Show it to an audience before I'm finished, before you lock the picture, because then there'll be things that are completely obvious to you that wouldn't be obvious to a member of an audience. And also that, you know, there are things that you might rethink and reshape. I've done that with every film and this film as well. And it was really helpful. There were things I thought were a given that were not clear to some people. So I, you know, it helped us shape it.
Right.
All right. And we've got one for you, Petunia. Greg Hulbert first says, bravo to phrase the praise in terms of the academic audience. but his question is, how do you feel / what do you hear when you channel the singing Brakeman?
That's a good question. I've not really analyzed it. I guess I'll have to take a look when inside, when I'm singing his songs. certainly full of emotion for me when I'm singing his songs. But I don't really know what's going on inside. To be honest, I haven't looked that hard. I just sing the songs and it feels good singing them. I wish I had more in depth answer.
No, that's good. That's concise and to the point.
And I would say feeling good when you sing music is probably the most important thing.
Yeah.
And making the audience feel good, which obviously also happened. So.
Yeah, and I guess that's all of the questions so far. But like I said, definitely check out the compliments, Beth and Petunia.
And we can get a copy of the chat, can't we, Scotty, that we can share?
I can send that out. And I think Petunia is going to do another song, correct?
He is. I just wanted, before we jumped into that, I wanted to tell our viewers about our upcoming next two virtual speaker series, in case you're interested in them. We have one on Tuesday, July 6th at 7 p.m. with photographer Tim Duffy. He is one of the co-founders of the Music Maker Relief Foundation, which is a wonderful foundation from Hillsborough, North Carolina, that supports primarily elderly blues musicians in being able to continue to make their music, but also to continue to get their medicine if they need it or pay their rent if they're having trouble with that. So just a financial and creative support network. Our current special exhibit is his exhibit, Our Living Past, which will be at the museum through September 30th. And so he's going to be talking about his work with Southern music makers and how he got into tintype photography, which is a wonderful and different way of doing photography. And then in August, on Tuesday, August 3rd, 7 p.m., we're going to have Professor Charlie DeHaan from Middle Tennessee State University, who is going to be talking to us about Henry Glover, who was a producer at King Records, and the intersection between country and blues music. So that's going to be really interesting. And then we're skipping September because all of us are going to be going crazy for the Bristol Rhythm and Roots reunion, and we can't put one more thing on our plate that month, but we'll be back in October. Really hope that you all can join us for other ones of these. You can find all the information about these on our website under birthplaceofcountrymusic.org under the events tab. And then finally, we will be sending out a survey to get your reactions to this program. So please, if you have time, fill that out and share that with us because we love to hear what you have to say. And it does help us decide what to look for our next programs. But before we move on, is there anything else that Beth or Petunia would like to say before Petunia does our final song for us? Hope you're muted, Beth.
There we go. Yeah, I wasn't unmuting. I just want to thank you for having us. This is so nice. And I noticed a couple of folks in the audience who had a part in other films that I just want to highlight.
One of them is
Deborah Silverstein, who is someone who is a fantastic musician in her own right, who wrote a fantastic song about the Carters, and she helped us get to the finish line with performing at a benefit that was done for the Winding Stream. So I want to thank her, shout out to her. And also want to thank Big Sandy's in the audience, and Big Sandy was in Welcome to the Club, introducing Janice Martin in it. And these are people, there's all these folks that, you know, you say it takes a village to make a film. And I thank them.
How about you, Petunia? Anything you want to say before we move on?
I want to thank both you and Scotty. Thank you very much for having us. It's a real honor to be playing a show that involves the birthplace of country music, a museum, and your whole organization. It's really nice to be here. Thank you.
Well, thank you. And we, like Scotty said earlier, it really means a lot to have you all here with us. This has been a great virtual speaker series program, really different from some of the ones previous. So I think people have really enjoyed it. And if the chat is anything to go by, they really, really did enjoy it. But also just a big thank you to everyone who attended tonight and who have supported us, because I know some of you are have been here for several of these programs, and we really appreciate that you keep coming back for more. So we hope that you'll continue doing that. But let's hear.
Oh, and Renee, I wasn't trying to rush you when I said Petunia was going to play again. I was just going to mention that I will post all of the links again while Petunia plays us out. But yeah, Beth, it's always a pleasure, and thank you for doing it. And Petunia, it was great meeting you, and thanks for playing some songs for us. And I hope to see you in Bristol again at some point.
Yeah, and remember, this will go up on our website in about a week's time. It's under the Museum at Home tab, and you can see this and other virtual speaker series that have been recorded there. So be sure and check it out if you need a second viewing, or if someone missed it and they want to see it, they can check it out there. But in the meantime, what are you going to sing for us, Petunia?
I'm gonna take it with the Jimmy Rogers song.
Awesome.
I'm gonna take it with a song he wrote called Treasures Untold.
That was lovely.
You're welcome.
Yeah, nice to start with the Carters and end with Jimmy Rogers. Well, thank you again to Beth and Petunia. Thank you to Scotty for being the tech whiz in the background.
And thank you, Renee.
Thank you. And thank you to everyone for being here. We have enjoyed spending our evening with you. And join us next month on Tuesday, July 6th. Bye, everyone.